Hi, this is Taj Mahal, and this is one of the fun things about playing ukulele, which I discovered in the last, well, I don't know, 10, 15 years or so, and play it because it's fun. It's just a little thing that you can carry around with you all the time. But as sure as the sun will shine, I'm gonna get my share now, what's mine. And then the harder they come, harder they fall, one and all. And the harder they come, harder they fall, one and all.
Sweeter than a honeybee, my baby be sweet on me. Sweeter than a honeybee, queen bee. Oh, she rocked me to my soul. Oh, she rocked me to my soul. Oh, she rocked me to my soul. Oh, she rocked me to my soul.
I don't remember a day in this life without music. Not one day, no time at all. I grew up in Springfield. Both my parents were musical. My mother was from South Carolina, and my father was from the Caribbean. The next door neighbor from North Carolina, this guy could play. I mean, I was on him like a posse. And then I was even luckier still that the neighbors up the street were from Clarksdale, Mississippi, where Muddy Waters and all those guys are from. So they had that kind of music. People were being inspired by him. As a youngster, I used to work over at the Eastern States Exposition on the weekend, mugging out stalls. And I ran into some youngsters over there. They were from other parts of New England, and they were in 4-H, and they were also in Future Farmers of America. My mother was a school teacher in West Springfield, and she said that my son is interested in agriculture, and maybe we can figure out something. They didn't have it in Springfield, so West Springfield had it, and they set it up so for me to come over there. One of the things with the West Springfield Future Farmers of America was they went up to the university. We were shown the barns and the experiments that were going on and some of the fields that were there, and we got a chance to see the herd that they had. This was something that was done. My parents would have probably liked for me to have gone to a traditional black college like Tuskegee or something of that nature, but they didn't have Tuskegee money and I didn't have Tuskegee marks. So the challenge to do well, it inspired me. So I became a really good student. It was great meeting the different people from different places, studying different things. It was fantastic, you know, for me. Agriculture, there's no culture in the world that's gonna get away without it. Was my Stockbridge School experience positive? Yes, very positive. I put it right up there with oxygen. There is an independent spirit that you learn through that Stockbridge that I really found myself being a part of. The university itself gave me a platform to really kind of work out some of my early ideas. In a few days of being here, you start finding out who's got guitars and mandolins, who can play jaw harp or harmonica, who's got a guitar, who's got some bongos or some congas, you know. And all that stuff was happening in music at that time, you know. I brought a lot of the music from my experience of rhythm and blues and jazz, jump blues and even gospel to, you know, the music that we had at the university. And we used to have battles of the bands, and there was a coffee house. It was a wonderful time to play music. And I was getting my guitar chops together, and you know, there was other music to listen to. People like Buffy St. Marie were going to school here, and she was like, been remained a lifelong friend. And I got to see concerts of Pete Seeger, Carlos Montoya, Jesse Fuller, the Brothers Four, the Four Freshmen, you know, things like that came through that were maybe different than my personal musical experience, but I went to see what was going on. They had hits on the radio, and so how did they do their show? Where the dining commons is and the women's dorms are, there is an absolutely natural amphitheater, that hillside there. Freshman women had to be in, I think it's 6 o'clock or 7 o'clock. And so after we'd come out of the dining commons, the guys would assemble there and we would just put on a show. You know, it would be Belafonte, it would be Deo, it would be Cindy. There's a lot of calypso that went down, all kinds of other folk songs, plenty Kumbaya, you know, and we had a captured audience right there. I had a band called The Electrics. How I got in was their lead singer flunked out while we played fraternities around campus. I kind of changed the lineup of the band. And we used to play the Quonset Club. It was solid in the Quonset Club. All those things were going on. Bob Dylan, this one, that one, Eric Von Schmidt, the music up in Boston. And there was a lot of folk music going on, and people were rediscovering Mississippi John Hurt. There was a lot of music going on. And the college, I think, certainly, that if I had not been going to the university, I wouldn't have been at the crossroads of a lot of this music, where I could go into a record store in town and thumb through and go like, oh, here's the new Tom Rush album. Well, here's another album by Mississippi John Hurt. Ooh, Sonny Terry and Brownie McGee. Reverend Gary Davis. You know, and all these people that if I went over to Springfield, you wouldn't see none of them. Now, you might see John Lee Hooker, you might see B.B. King, T-Bone Walker, Smokey Hawk, you know, Lowell Fulsom. I could name quite a few that would be there, but there wouldn't be that whole folk thing. And that was a big opening for me. That led me to the Newport Folk Festival. Everybody knew the Newport Jazz Festival, but Newport Folk Festival, what would that be like? Really? Oh, you mean people come out to hear that music in the big droves? Sure, 30,000 of them. To me, it was a phenomenon. What is it about all these guys up here in New England that are connected to these people down in Mississippi and Arkansas and South Carolina, North Carolina, Tennessee, or Louisiana, Texas? It was very interesting. I didn't realize how significant the New England connection to our traditional music had actually helped boost it. I didn't have the money to buy a farm. And I didn't really want to work for somebody else for the rest of my life. I found out what my journey was. It was to re-weld the music back to the agriculture, which is the original way things were. The music came out of people being able to work and create this kind of music. And the music started peeling off, and a little bit at a time, it started getting better and looking like I could make a living at it. And the way the industry was structured at the time, you had to make a big hit for the record company. And once you gave them the big hit, then they might be nice to you, you know? And I didn't like those odds. So I just went my own way, developed an audience so that I could play all the time and tour. And that was what it was all about for me. We had some good success in the 60s, and the rest of it is history. Champagne, don't drive me crazy, cocaine. I'm responsible for the outcome of this music every day, every time I go out and play. It's exciting, it's totally inspiring. 0 to 7 is all you get until you become conscious and start working on it. So you gotta challenge yourself every day. You are what you are where you are, and you have to make the best of what you have. And you have to open the door to some other possibilities.